Dave Oliphant is a retired professor from UT, spent 30 years teaching here, lecturer in English, rhetoric, and writing. He's the editor of a scholarly journal called The Library Chronicle. He's an award-winning poet, author, jazz aficionado, critic, author, and historian, and he has translated two collections of Chilean poetry. Also with us tonight is Cary Ratcliff, a musician and an award-winning composer whose work you will be hearing tonight. He's written opera, art songs, chamber music, and oratorio, plays keyboards with the Rochester Philharmonic Orchestra. He's the newly appointed artistic director of the Madrigalia Chamber Choir, and Fanfare magazine calls him a writer of deeply expressive and very beautiful music. I think you're going to have a terrific conversation with these gentlemen. Without further ado.
And it'd be more fun for us if you were down here where we could see you and you could see us. So if you're up there, come on down, get the good seats down here.
Well, my name is Dave Oliphant, and I've long been interested in Chilean poetry, and I was delighted to be invited to participate in this very unusual program based on the poetry of the great Pablo Neruda. I never knew Neruda personally when I was in Chile on many occasions. He was never there. He was usually in Paris or elsewhere. I visited his three homes and read his poetry avidly for years. And so it's a real privilege to be able to share a few thoughts about his work and about this program that you'll be hearing tonight, specifically Ode to Common Things by Cary Ratcliff. I've prepared some remarks, and if you'll bear with me, I'm going to read from them. I'm not a very good extemporaneous speaker, and especially in order to quote a number of passages from poetry, I've never been very good about remembering poetry to recite it. I remember specific words and images. They're indelibly printed on my mind, but I'm not too good about quoting. So with your forbearance, I'll read my remarks. Poet William Carlos Williams of Paterson, New Jersey, wrote a poem entitled Tribute to Neruda, the Poet Collector of Seashells, in which Williams writes that the Chilean poet collected seashells on his native beaches until he had, by reputation, the second largest collection in the world. The changeless beauty of seashells, like the sea itself, gave his lines the variable pitch which modern verse requires. Although Williams was primarily interested in Neruda because of the Chilean's use of the variable pitch, the importance of Neruda as a collector of seashells, and in fact of the most common things, is more to the point tonight when we shall hear a wonderful collection of five of Neruda's odes set to music by composer Cary Ratcliff. The composer has selected from Neruda's 225 odes a handful that demonstrates the epic vision of this poet who won the Nobel Prize in 1971 and whose poetry is considered perhaps the greatest of the 20th century. The odes are among Neruda's most popular poems, and this is easy to understand, since they celebrate common themes by revealing our intimate relationships with objects like those that the poet collected in his home at Isla Negra on the Pacific shore, from seashells to bottles, dishes, musical instruments, figureheads of ships, children's dolls, figurines of horses, and books, including first editions of the poetry of Walt Whitman, and the dictionaries to which he also wrote an ode, paying homage to their storehouse of vocabulary, their magnanimous granaries, the words shining in their inexhaustible cup, opaque or sonorous, fertile in the lodging of language, charged with truth and sound, and their lines that suddenly seem as delicious and smooth in our mouths as an almond or as tender as a fig. In his dictionary ode, Neruda asked that it let fall on his lips one tremor, one sound, one seed, closing his poem by declaring, "I am made of earth, and with words I sing." Of the five odes chosen by Cary Ratcliff, Ode to Scissors has long been one of my favorite Neruda poems. The reason for this is that the poet has seen in this single object the story of our lives from birth to death. In Ode to Things, the first poem in the composer's symphonic five-movement choral and instrumental setting, Neruda states, quote, "A multitude of things has shown me the whole picture." This is especially true of the Ode to Scissors, where this simple tool that crosses our lives like two rivers or two knives cuts the umbilical cord to give each person his separate existence. Neruda's image of crossing and cutting always reminds me of Alexander Pope's great paradox in his mock epic, The Rape of the Lock, where he says that the two blades of the scissors join to divide. That not only do scissors cut skin, but hair, fingernails, knots in the body, and every type of cloth, from that used in making a nation's flag, bloodied as bandages by war, but clothing worn at a wedding and in a funeral coffin. Finally, the poet says that with the scissors of good sense, he will cut short his ode so that it won't go on too long and can be folded and fit in a reader's pocket ready for use. The composer's Latin-style music for this ode reflects the playfulness of the ode's ending. But as one line of the ode has it, "The scissors cut everything, swatches of joy and sorrow, sadness, in equal measure." The other odes chosen by the composer echo many of these same ideas and also contain some of the same images and similes or metaphors found in the Scissors Ode. For example, in the Ode to the Guitar, which consummates a marriage between musician and instrument, the poet says that the guitar leaves its case like a bird's nest and flies to the hands of the man or woman who plays it. Just as the scissors, kept in their sewing basket like a nest, fly in the barbershop. Like the scissors, the guitar touches both sorrow and joy of the deepest hour. When the mezzo-soprano sings that last phrase in Spanish, La profunda oda, it is to me one of the most deeply beautiful and moving passages of the composer's setting. Like the bloodied flag in the Scissors Ode, the bloodied sheets in Ode to the Bed are but one side to the imagistic and emotional range of Neruda's writing. For the Bed Ode is also epic in scope, covering the life of a person from birth to death, with the bed a sea of struggle, but also of love, with its soft sheets like bright banners of white lily, where we slip into embrace and into the unceasing marriage of dreams. The final ode in the composer's five-movement setting serves to illustrate once again the far-reaching significance of one common thing, our daily bread, a yoking of seed and fire. The relationship between this simple, profound food and human life is so fundamental that it represents, quote, the will to live and every human being's right to his and her share of life. This concluding movement is a call for all humankind to join in the struggle to ensure that all things, and above all, the nourishment of bread, be shared equally and open-handedly. As the bread rises in the oven, it takes on, in Neruda's view, characteristics of the human body, growing suddenly like hips, mouths, breasts, and impregnated wombs, until the hot blast of fertility transfixes it the color of gold. Such richness, he proclaims, is to be sown and harvested enough for not just one man, but for all. Bread for all the peoples. The rousing conclusion to Cary Ratcliff's varied and wide-ranging setting of and tribute to Pablo Neruda's ode is a choral and instrumental version of two of the poet's principal themes: his appreciation of life in all its forms that became such an integral part of his very existence, and a concern that everyone, everywhere, should enjoy the fruits of the earth's prodigious quotidian things.
Thank you, Dave. I didn't know that your favorite, I'm glad that I picked Scissors, since it was one of your favorites. And what you don't know is that Dictionary was the next on the list. If I'd written another one, it would have been to set the dictionary. And I love the way he starts, because it said, when I was a young man, I had this big fat dictionary, and I just threw it behind the sofa because I already knew all the words I needed. I just laid there and gathered dust for years. And then one day, it put down roots and it sprouted and it grew a giant tree. And there were these wonderful words hanging all over my living room. And then I was humbled. Yeah, that's great. So it was 20 years ago that I was approached in my hometown by the Rochester Oratorio Society for their 50th anniversary to write a piece for them. And I did not start out looking at Neruda. My approach was to find words from some visionary, someone who was eloquent, or people who were eloquent at that time, someone post-Martin Luther King, who told us how we should live, what our life should be like, what our ultimate human values were together. And the together part was important because, unlike art song, where it's one person saying the words of a poet and it can be a very personal experience, or even a lot of choral pieces where people gather together and they say, here's what we have to say. An oratorio is 150 people singing, and they all have to have something in common. They all have to agree on something. And there are plenty of things that we don't agree on. So to find those words that we can all share is a special challenge of finding a text for an oratorio. So I was looking at Desmond Tutu and Vaclav Havel and Jimmy Carter at that time, saying, you know, what do these guys have to say? And I asked about 150 people, who are the people speaking for the future that we should have as human beings. And I got about 170 different names, which was sort of terrifying and didn't give me the answer I wanted. But I thought, well, either we're so various that we really don't know who's speaking for our age, or we really don't know until 20, 30 years later, maybe, who has spoken most eloquently. And as I was looking around at other things, I came across some Pablo Neruda books, some ones that I hadn't known and was reading, and discovered, well, rather than this high road of virtues and visions and things like that, this guy's talking about how we're connected through everyday common objects and experiences. And I said, well, that's a whole different approach, and that really works. And I started reading, and just one after another, they tumbled out for me. And I said, this is the way to go. The problem was they were in Spanish. And so I had to go to the board and say, look, I found this great stuff, it's in Spanish. And they said, well, you know, we'd really like an English oratorio. I said, well, you know, I grew up in California, and every night, you know, the Inigises next door, they were always speaking Spanish, and I went to sleep hearing Spanish every night. And so I know the music of that language, and, you know, it's sort of here to stay. It's an American language. And I said, I don't know. I said, let me bring some stuff, and I'll sing it for you. So I pounded around on the piano and wailed at the first movement, which you'll hear tonight. And I said, you know, it's about the rhythm of these words. I could put it in English, and it wouldn't work. It's not just about the meaning. It's about the musical meaning of the poems, because they have wonderful rhythm, and that's where a lot of the rhythms from the piece come from, is just the natural rhythm of the words. It's quasi-verse. And so they got it. It was a room full of 20 people, and I just made a lot of racket, and they said, yeah, we get it. Okay, so that was very nice. So I did get to do that. So originally it was written for a large group with orchestra, and actually it was done here by the Austin Symphony with Peter Bay 5 or 6 years ago, and Craig Hella Johnson trained the symphonic chorus for that, and that's how we got to know this piece. And he and other people had been saying, what about a chamber version of this, where we don't have to have an orchestra and you can do it with a smaller choir? Ladies and gentlemen, that is what's happening tonight, so this is the first round of performances of this. So instead of an orchestra, you have two people at a piano sitting close, two percussionists hitting everything, and you just watch them and you'd be amazed, and a harp player, and so I call it the ten-hand version. But also because there's, yeah, 10 hands, they're very busy. But we also added, for this set of performances, we added the guitar back in, because there's one whole ode that's about the guitar. And so he has sort of a big role, and Craig said, can we include him back in? And I said, sure. So he's here playing that part, and the harp and the piano and things that were going to play that part, they don't get to play then. So you'll hear the guitar, and it was a great idea of Craig's to do that. So that's what we're hearing tonight. Now, I know we want to have some questions for you, but I'm guessing you might have more questions, or better questions, if I share some music first. So I'll go over to the piano, I'll do a little show and tell and say, here's what this sounds like, here's what this sounds like for a little while, and then I know you'll have questions. So. So Dave already gave you ideas of a lot of these things. The first poem is a long list of Neruda. His mind is just bubbling, and he's listing all kinds of things that he loves. And so I just got the bubbling of his mind here at the open. And then the singers sing, I love all things. I have a crazy love of things. And the men sing, crazy, crazy, you are crazy, crazy, crazy. They're singing in Spanish, loca, loca, locamente, loca, loca, locamente. Now, of course, it's just two words in Neruda's. He goes, loca, locamente, all right? But I use it about 17 times because I get a little refrain going there out of it, all right? I like pliers, scissors. Me gustan las tenazas, las tijeras. You can see how I took the language and just used the rhythm that was inherent to it. Let's see, I love things. I love all things, not only the grandest, but the infinitely small things. All right, so. Chicas, 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 el dedo. Chicas, 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 los floreros, las espuelas. So they're singing chicas, 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 very tiny things he adores, as well as all the big things he's talking about. And then he breaks out into a culminating phrase here, ah, yes, my soul, the planet is beautiful. And the ladies are singing just this. Craig wants them to get a floating kind of a sound as they sing, alma mia, hermoso es el planeta. Which is just the right idea for me. Like it's your soul floating, flying over the earth, looking at this and being in the frame of mind to appreciate the beauty all around us. Let's see, I'm jumping around here. Oh, one line I especially like here, the latest bloodless rebirth of gold. So I'm thinking even this gold band on my finger here, you know, maybe it was Inca gold at one, I guess they mostly did silver, didn't they? Inca gold, you know, stolen by the Spaniards, taken there, turned into ingots, and ended up and melted down again, probably in Austin somewhere in the early 19th century, and then ended up in Rochester. You know, so it's probably had lots of different lives, touched by lots of different fingers, and that's his point here, is that all these things have on their traces, let's see, the traces of someone's hand long lost in forgottenness. I love all things, not only because they are fragrant or ardent, but because I don't know, what a great line, but because I don't know, because this ocean is yours, it's mine. So he says, sino porque no sé, porque este océano es el tuyo, es el mío. Okay, I'll just play a little of that. No sé, porque este océano es el tuyo, es el mío. He goes into a long list again, botones, ruedas, pequeños tesoros olvidados, but I like the rhythm of it. Los botones, botones, ruedas, ruedas, pequeños tesoros olvidados, botones, botones, ruedas, ruedas. Well, you'll hear them accelerando all together at the same time. He goes on singling out other things, and finally it all rolls up into a giant ball. And then they come out, here's the giant rolling ball. And then they all sing together, O river, O unstoppable river of things. I love all kinds of things. It's not true that I loved only things that ascend, survive, and aspire. A multitude of things has shown me the whole picture. And then he gets to his serious point here. And so I give him a little bit of serious music here. Not only was I touched by them, or they by my hand, but they became such an integral part of my very existence. They were for me so alive that they lived half my life and will die half my death. And it ends on that thought. The second movement is a bed, and David already pointed out how the scissors was sort of a unifying metaphor of all kinds of things in life. In the fun way, the ode to the bed is sort of the dark side. So all cultures have beds, but what a unifying metaphor for life experiences. The poem, from bed to bed, we go this journey of life, the wounded, the dying, the lover, the dreamer, all have come and will go forth from bed to bed. And so there's something pretty tempestuous about this. Later, the bed becomes a seabed, and we hear images of the sea, again tempestuous, frothy surface of life. And a soprano comes out and sings over the froth of the ocean. And all 10 hands are very busy playing softly, creating this froth over which she sings. Let's see. Oh! And then the darkest part of the whole piece at the end of this, then into our bed comes death with rusted hands and iodine tongue, and she raises her finger, long as a road, pointing us to the shore, the doorway of our final pain. And so I had to find music for that. Pretty gruesome image there, but again, a common experience. Let me talk for about 2 more minutes here at the piano, then we'll come and we'll chat. So the next movement is the guitar. So guitar is one of the most common instruments around the world. To all cultures have things like it, sitars, zithers, all right, banjos, all things like this. But also from it, there are all kinds of images of shared experience of life. Now, I took the harmony for this right from the guitar. The open strings of the guitar, which are, when you hear those of you who tune guitars, you know those notes very well, okay? And there are 6 parts here. There are 2 soprano parts, an alto part, a tenor part, a baritone part, and a bass part. So the chorus is singing in 6 parts. So the guitar gives them their pitches just with open strings. And that's their opening chord. And that's a harmony that comes back throughout this movement. And sometimes some of them will move as a group, like a bar chord for you, those of you guitarists. All these wonderful 6-note chords. You survive by singing, and Dave already told us about that. It's born in the jungle, so I did a little jungle music here. We're talking about Ecuadorian jungle, right? And then there are spooky sounds that the percussion are doing as we talk about the birth of the guitar out of the jungle. You know, that's enough. Let's talk. So are there questions for either of us? Sure.
Well, they're all totally different. One is Isla Negra, which I think is probably the most fascinating because there's so much more to it. It's like several buildings. One of the fascinating things about it, in terms of Cary Ratcliff's Ode to the Bed, is that on the second floor of one of the buildings, I mean, it's an incredible view. The bedroom, the bed faces out on the Pacific, tumbling in, and out in the rocks, a student, some student years ago, it's still there though, painted a picture of Neruda, and you can still see it on the rocks out there. And he could have seen it from the bedroom. He and Matilda on their bed could see all of that ocean. I mean, it's just incredible. Another very striking thing about the Isla Negra property is that some students decided to bring an iron train to him as a present. And I don't remember how many miles, 50 or 100 miles, they pulled this thing. I mean, it's gigantic. I mean, they didn't have rails. I don't know how they got it there, but it's in the front of his house. It's a beautiful piece of equipment. You know, it's like, it was a steam engine, and it's red. And of course, he collected everything. He has one. There's one whole room in one of the buildings that's devoted entirely to figureheads off of ships, mostly ships that had wrecked, and he salvaged the figureheads. You know, these women with, nude women with the bust out at the prow of the ship. I mean, he has, I don't know how many of them. So it's just, it's a fabulous place for all the collections that he had. In Santiago, the capital, he had a home there. It's quite different. It's a city dwelling, but it has some beautiful gardens and interesting buildings. And then the other one that that I prefer is in Valparaiso. Again, it's a coastal city, but his house was way up on the hillside. The whole city is built on a cliff, and to get to these houses, you have to ride a funiculare, and so his house is way up there, overlooking the bay, and so much that he describes has to do with the sea, and everywhere he went, at least to those two homes, I should say, not in Santiago, but when he would go to Valparaiso or to Isla Negra, he always had an incredible view of the ocean. And you can see why it influenced his poetry so much.
So we've gotten a signal, so maybe we should come down to the last two questions. You had one there?
I understood you correctly. You said that there were over 200 of those accomplished.
225.
I did not read even 100 of them. Right? I had two books in selection, and before I got through them, I had seven that I thought would be great. And then as I got composing, I said, these five, say it. They say what needs to be said. It's 45 minutes. That's where it has to end. And the fifth one, Bread, he gets a little bit serious, and it's the only one that's really a little bit political. And he talks about, we need to share bread. And then a soprano stands up and she says, and if we don't, and she gets very indignant, and you think the piece is about to end, and then she gets up and she says, and if we don't. Yeah, so that becomes a special message at the end of the piece.
I think it's wonderful, Cary, that the five poems really fit together beautifully. I mean, it must have been something very intuitive in you that you saw immediately the connections among these poems, because I'd be hard for me to think of a better combination. It's really terrific.
Well, I'm glad you feel that way. It wasn't immediate because I wrote half of the dictionary, and I wrote half of artichokes, artichofa.
Oh, I love
so
that.
So they're in sketch, and I never did finish them because they weren't needed, but these five ended up fitting together.